I have been using Linux Mint as my daily driver for almost 2 years now, and these are some of the things that I do every time I reinstall it. The first thing is just a visual change. I changed the terminal color scheme from this, which is the default in Linux Mint, to this, which is a theme called Tender. In my opinion, it looks better and it has a higher contrast between the colors. Let's also run htop so that you can see more of the colors in action and see the difference. So now I'm going to reset the terminal back to its default configuration and show you how to install this theme from scratch. Okay. So the tool I use to install the theme is called GOG, and you can find it on this GitHub page or simply by searching GOG color scheme on your favorite search engine. And to use this tool, we are going to run this command, but before executing it, I highly recommend you to go to your terminal preferences, to the profile section, and click on the plus sign and create a new profile. Let's give it a name, for example, custom, create. Now close these preferences, and now you can execute this, because if you don't create the profile before you execute the command, the command may fail. So now press enter, and this is going to give you a list of all the themes that are available on this tool. And in my case, the theme I want is called Tender, and it currently has the number 214. But this number may change because the color schemes are ordered alphabetically and there are constantly new themes being added to the list. So the numbers may change with the time. And I also am going to install another good theme that I recommend, which is called Monokai Dark, which has the number 135 as of this recording. So let's install both of them, 214 space 135. And enter. That has just installed both of our themes. And now to activate the theme we want, which we go to preferences again, and in this profile section you can see that we have two new entries, Monokai Dark and Tender. And to activate any theme, you can just click on this down arrow and set as default. Now we close the terminal, and the next time we open it, it's going to have the theme we installed, as you can see. All right, I think, yeah, this is Tender, and I'm going to activate Monokai Dark so that you can also see it. This is Monokai Dark, which is also a good looking theme. And finally, I go back to preferences and enable the custom font checkbox, and in my case I want the font to be 14. This looks bigger than normal because I had already manually increased the size, but if I open a new terminal, it's going to open with a reasonable size, which is in my opinion better than the default, which is like this, it's too small. So those are my terminal style configurations. The next thing I do is add some bash aliases to my terminal. So let's actually keep working on the terminal. So imagine we are working on this directory inside Etsy, and I'm configuring some files. Let's say I'm modifying this file, and I want to go two levels up in the directory hierarchy. So the normal way that you would do this is by typing cd space dot dot slash dot dot, right? But I actually have an easier way that I always use. So let's go back to that directory. To go one level up in the directory hierarchy, I just type up like that. And if I want to go two levels up in the directory hierarchy, I just type up twice, up space up, and that way it's much faster to navigate the directories that you may want to browse. So to do this, I only change one file and add this as an alias, as a bash alias. So let's go to that file. You can find this file in your home directory, and that file is called .bashrc. And I'm going to edit that file. In my case, I'm going to use NeoVim, but you can use any editor you want. And we open this file, we go to the end of the file, and here we're just going to add a few empty lines, and I'm going to add this alias space app equals double quotes, and make sure that this is all together without spaces. Then cd space dot dot and semicolon, and then double quotes again. That's all you have to type, and then write the file or save the file and quit. And now we need to close this terminal so that the changes take effect. We'll open a new terminal, and if we type app, we can see that it works. So let's go back to our home directory, and we type app space app. It also works. What doesn't work is typing app altogether. Because of the way that bashrc aliases work, this won't work unless you define another alias, which I'm going to do right now, in the same file, bashrc. Go to the end again and define a similar alias, but this time we define it as app equals cd dot dot slash dot dot semicolon double quotes. We save this file, and again, we close this terminal, we open a new terminal. I'm gonna increase the size so that you can see. And now if we type app all together, it should work, as you can see. Okay, so imagine we go back to that directory structure that we were working in. It was 80. And let's say sources. So we're working here, but I want to go to back to Etsy. Instead of typing cd dot dot slash dot dot, I can just type app. And this makes it so much easier and more comfortable to work on the terminal, for me at least. So I recommend you use this alias too. So that's the second thing I do when I reinstall Linux Mint. The next thing I do is configuring Firefox. I use Firefox as my main browser, and there are some tweaks that I deem essential. First, I open this menu and go to More Tools and Customize Toolbar. And I disable this title bar checkbox. So the title bar uses a lot of vertical space for no reason, and vertical space, especially in 16:9 display resolutions or aspect ratios, is very valuable. So I make sure to make good use of it. And another thing that helps me save a little bit of vertical space is changing the density of the browser tabs. But as you can see, there are two options, and the default is already the smaller one. But there's an additional hidden third option known as compact mode that we can activate. So to activate that option, we have to go to a new tab and type in the address bar about colon config. We accept the risk and continue. And here we are going to type compact in here. And this is gonna show us a list of options, but we care about the first one, browser.compactmode.show. And we go to the right here, and we press this button. And that is going to toggle this variable from false to true. Now we go back to the Customize Firefox tab, and here in the density, you will see that there is a third option now, which is compact. And this makes it save some vertical space in my browser. And if you pay attention, it says not supported, but I haven't had any issues with it, and I've used it for like more than 1 year and I have anything buggy or glitchy about it. So I just always use it, always enable it in the about config, and then select this mode here. And going on with the vertical space optimizations, the other thing I do is move this panel to the left. So I just right click it, move, and click here. And this is another thing that helps me save vertical space. But as you can see, now the time here is separated. Like, as you can see, the hours are separated from the minutes. And I personally don't like that. Maybe you like it, but I don't. So I go into configure. I enable the custom date format here. I change this format string, delete all except the hours and the minutes, and put a space behind before the hours and a space after the minutes. And this way I can see the hour and the minutes all in just one line, not separated. And of course, I also changed the desktop background. In my case, I like this one. And I changed this menu icon of the icon of the main menu. I right click it, go to configure, select the icon and change it for this icon instead. Select and close this. And in my opinion, it looks better. I don't like seeing the Linux Mint logo everywhere. So this looks better in my opinion. Next in the list, another thing I do is disabling all the Cinnamon features that I don't like. And one of those features is notifications. For example, whenever a new song starts playing on Spotify, which I have running here, so I'm gonna skip the song, and there's a notification here. I skip again, and these notifications appear every time that a new song starts playing, even if I don't trigger the song. And I find it kind of distracting and useless, so I disable those notifications. So I open the main menu, type notifications, and disable them in this toggle. But this doesn't solve the notification problem completely. Sure, notifications will stop appearing up here, but I'm gonna skip another song again. And as you can see, this area still saves the notifications. And I don't like having this either. So what I do is, look, you can clear the notifications, but next time they will appear again, next time you skip a song. So what I do is just right click here and remove notifications. And that solves the notification problem for me. Another small thing that I don't like is visual effects. So whenever I close a window, you can see there's like a little animation, and I don't really want that. So I open the main menu, type effects, open this application, and just disable all of the effects here. Like, there's a ton of different effects and I don't really want any of them, so I just disable them. Now let's imagine that you just installed VS Code using the .dev package downloaded from the VS Code website. And you open the menu because you want to execute VS Code, and you just type code and you type enter. But you didn't open the application. You instead opened the .dev package. Because when you type code, the first result is not the application, but the .dev package. And even if you imagine, let's delete this package and open the main menu again and type code again, it still appears here because this cache takes time to get updated. So this file, in my opinion, is just obstructing my good use of the computer, because I only care about applications. When I type something here, I only want applications to appear. I don't want files. So I just disable that feature. And just to give you another reason to disable this feature, imagine you're screen sharing your desktop on some video conference application, and you go to the main menu and you type, I don't know, one letter, M. And there are some files here, and this file maybe is some secret file or some private information, and maybe you even have maybe even the name of the file is sensitive. And maybe you don't want to show this to all the people that are on your video conference. So that's another reason to disable the this feature. So let's disable it now. We right-click the main menu icon and go to configure. And here we go to the second tab, the menu tab. We go to the show reasons option and we disable this toggle. And now, whenever we type, let's type, for example, M again, medical, and nothing said, nothing appears. We type code, and only the Visual Studio Code application shows up, not the file. So we solve that problem now. And finally, the last thing I do is changing my keyboard configuration. I do two things with the keyboard. The first one is swapping the caps lock key with the escape key. So one reason for doing that is, of course, if you're using Vim or NeoVim, that typing escape allows you to swap from the insert mode to the other modes in the editor. So in that case, you use escape key a lot. But I find that even if you're not using Vim or NeoVim, I use the escape key a lot. So imagine that we are typing something here and I want this to disappear. I just type escape. I can be, I don't know, here and click here. And I am going down in the list, but I just want this list to be closed now. So I type escape. So I use the escape key a lot more than the caps lock key, and I like to have it more accessible in the home row of the keyboard. So it's much closer and I don't have to do a movement to get to the escape key. So there are many reasons apart from Vim to swap the escape and the caps lock key. So how do you do that? How do you swap them? You go here, type keyboard, open this, go to the third tab, the layouts tab, go to options, caps lock behavior, and you just select this one, swap and caps lock, and just close it. And now whenever you type the caps lock key, the operating system is going to interpret that caps lock key as an escape key. So let's say we're typing here, we press the caps lock, but it works as escape. So that's much easier to work in Vim, but also in other programs. So that's swapping caps lock key and escape. But another thing I do is adding an additional keyboard layout. So in my case, my native language is Spanish, but I use the English US layout most of the time. But I still need to type in Spanish sometimes. So I come here to the layouts tab and add the Spanish Latin American layout. And now I can simply swap between both of these using the Windows plus space key at the same time, or super and space, however you want to call it. And as you can see, here is the indicator for what is the currently active layout, Latin American Spanish or English US. And I don't like to have a US flag here, so I just disable this toggle. Now it's better. Latin American Spanish or English US. So I can just type things in English with the US layout. Hi, I'm using Linux. And I can press super and space, or Windows and space, and then type something in Spanish using, if I need to type the letter ñ or the accented characters. For example, la fábrica de ñandús. And then I go back to the US layout easily with super and space. Back to English. And those are all the things that I wanted to show you today. I hope you found at least one useful thing that you are going to use from now on. And if you did, please subscribe and like the video and put a comment below, and see you next time. Thanks for watching.